Kia ora whānau. Welcome back to this awesome episode of Konei Kōrero. I am so excited because I've been fangirling over these two. I probably watch them more than they realise. And it's always awkward when you've seen someone online and then you see them face to face, eh? You get a little bit shy. But I'm excited because it's really cool to see Māori or just artists in Aotearoa that are doing well, that have cracked both creativity and entrepreneurship. And are using that to live the life that they want to live. And so I feel like we're going to have an awesome kōrero today. I have both, you know what, I don't even know your real name, but the Hori and his beautiful wife Mimi, is that right? Kia ora kōroa.
Kia ora.
Kei te pihia kōroa?
Pai.
Pai, pai. All right, well, let's kick off. Why don't you introduce yourselves first to the whānau out there?
Kei te pai. Kia ora. Nau mai haere mai ki te whare toi o Hori, no ki Ōtaki. I pia me tīmata toki mihi. Ki tau toku kuia no Ngāti Kaha Nunu ki Wairarapa, Kaitahu hoki, ki te taho toku Kraua, Ngāti Toa Rangatira, and ka tipu ake au ki Ōtaki. And ai, nainei, Māua. Me amato whānau, e noho ana ki Ōtaki anō. Ai.
I mean, kia ora, bro.
The Mia.
Kia ora, I'm Mia. I'm actually from Australia. So my dad's part Indigenous Australian, so that's very special. And, yeah, I've been living in Ōtaki in nearly 4 or 5 years.
Ai.
Yep. And we've been... Yeah, creating this.
Awesome.
Yeah.
What part of Australia is your whānau from?
Northern, northwest New South Wales.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's called Mōri.
Mōri.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah. It's beautiful to meet you both. I'm looking forward to our kōrero. Why don't we just warm up? Tell us a little bit about what goes on here in Ōtaki. Why Ōtaki? What's so beautiful about this town?
Yeah. Well, I grew up here. Me and my brothers, my younger brother was born here, but we all went to Raukawa Kohanga out Tainui Marae there.
Mm.
So that's kind of 35 years ago. And now we kind of was here for about 8-9 years, and then we went to a kura, Reorua, in Te Awaho, and then kind of went off later off in our journeys. But yeah, I kind of always wanted to come back here. My nan was out on the beach. When we were over in Aussie, it just kind of, we kept seeing the space every time we came back home. And we're like, oh, we could do it. I was like, well, if there was one town to do it in, was to come back to Ōtaki and create this gallery. And yeah, either here or the Wairarapa, I feel where I can stand. Especially with, Ngāti Toa on this kind of side of the Tararoa, and then in Wairarapa as well.
Mm.
Kind of see it as two places I can stand and be okay,
choice.
And safe. So
it's important, eh?
Oh,
especially in the mahi that you do, I think.
Yeah,
Because you're a disruptor.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you need somewhere safe when you do stuff like that, eh?
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. And we've been here for...
Nearly 5 years.
Yeah.
Yep.
I came through Ōtaki a couple of years ago. I had a mate at Raukawa doing a reo journey there.
Yep.
And we came and we actually did a bit of a hikoi, actually. Me and my dad, so my dad's side's Pākehā, and my nephew, and my dad wanted to do a bit of a hikoi just to kind of connect his whakapapa. And so his whānau, our Yuri whānau, came into Petone in 1840. And then after being part of the Cornish crew that helped build up Petone, moved over to Wairarapa in the Greytown.
Wow.
Yeah, and actually one of my ancestors was the mayor of Greytown at one stage. And so we did a hiding it down Wairarapa, then all the way down to Petone. And then on our way back here, we stopped in to see my mate. She took us up the river for a swim to the pots.
Yeah.
And I got my drone out and flew it around and it dropped signal and it just got blown into the bush. But she was so awesome. She went up the gorge, climbed up the rocks, got a stick, flicked it off, but it fell into the river.
Oh.
She dived in and got it and swam it back down. The ended up Pakaru, but I got my memory card back and got the insurance. So I got some funny memories of this town, but I'm impressed by Ōtaki.
Did you just say your grandparents were Cornish?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Our whānau. Udi is our whānau name. Oh, I don't even know.
I used to live in Cornwall.
Did you?
Yeah, in Penzance.
Oh, loved wow. It, yeah. We've never actually been over to make that honunga, but
proper job. Yeah, no, nah, it's awesome.
Cornish pastries and all that.
Oh, yeah.
But no, I mean, tell us a little bit about your brand, what you guys do.
Oh, it's a real fusion at the moment.
Yeah, I bet.
So we've been able. Oh, we've been fortunate enough to be able to create an apparel label. Well, Hori was already doing apparel when I met him, and from there we've just kind of been able to fuse some of our things together.
Mm.
So I love textile art and design, and definitely into more of the actual fabrications.
Mm.
So I've been able to sort of put my little spin on some of the Hori collection, which has been really lovely for me. Yeah, I'd be a bit lost if I wasn't doing clothing.
Yeah.
I really love it.
Yeah.
Choice. Yeah. Oh, I was doing like more artwork all around Wellington, like more kind of street work.
Mm.
And then someone got in contact with me and was like from Middle Motor, which is the Māori fashion board.
Mm.
And Atta there was like, you should enter this competition. They wanted to put the prints on tees, on t-shirts.
Oh, yeah.
And, yeah, so I ended up doing really well. And then so I went from doing that artwork and then going into this weird fashion world.
Yeah.
But it was awesome because that's how I met.
That's how we met, yeah.
Up at Fashion Week.
Yeah.
And then with this and what we've been doing lately, I've been able to step back from all the kākahu, which has been awesome.
Yeah.
And Mia does all of it, and I just can concentrate on the art mahi, which is really what I love doing.
Mm.
And so Mia does all of the clothing side of it.
Yeah.
All the niggly shit.
Yeah.
I enjoy it.
Yeah, good on you. Yeah. So you have your kākahu, your clothing line, you have the art that you do yourself.
Aye.
And then you have a gallery that you run here too, right?
Aye, yeah.
Yep.
So the gallery, we have same type of artists, kind of quite edgy, predominantly Māori artists. We've got a couple of Pākehā artists that are kind of on the same wavelength as us in terms of their kaupapa and what they're doing. But, yeah, it's a nice blend of kind of artists, and we bounce well off each other. Yeah, it's quite cool.
Yeah.
It's like contrast all around, which is nice. It's not all the same.
Yeah, me.
There's
so much I want to talk about. Like, I want to talk about that, like what it's like to work with other artists, put in that collective. But I feel like I just rewind a little bit first hear a little bit about your guys' journeys as creatives and how you ended up as full-time artists. Like, yeah, where did you start and how did you get here?
Jump in, mate.
Tricky. Where did it start? For me, I was always drawn to art and went straight out of high school and did design and fundamentals in Sydney. My mum lives in Sydney and I grew up in Sydney.
Mm.
And for later on in life, went on to study up north, visual arts again.
Mm.
And then I always did quite a lot of textile work, which... yeah, I just loved making things. Even though I'm actually a terrible sewer, I still really just had a lot of passion for it.
Yeah.
And then one thing led to another. I started upcycling things and doing the markets and making bags, making, you know, whatever I could kind of wing.
Mm.
And then I was in Byron. I can't remember the year. It might have been early 2000s. And one of the ladies that had a really amazing boutique in Byron said, oh, I'd like to enter you in this competition. And I was like, okay, you know, didn't really have a clue. But, and I ended up winning that.
Awesome.
and similar to what Hori, like the same sort of thing. And years and years down the track after doing markets and this and that, I ended up being asked to join a collective to create an Indigenous Australian Fashion Week. Awesome. And that was such a cool experience. Mm. And that was a lot of work. And we, just two of us, Grace and myself, got invited to come over to New Zealand to be a part of the Miramura, sort of like a cultural crossover. It was really awesome. So yeah, I came over and met this guy. We had this really nice
Sparks
connection.
Sparks flew.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sound effects.
Hang on. That was a joke.
We had a good laugh, a really good time, great bunch of artists that and designers that, you know, still friends with, and
yeah, awesome.
It was incredible. And that's just how it went. It was just organically kind of happened, but always in the art to begin with.
Yeah.
And, like, I used to, yeah, lots of textiles on cloth and then turning them into, so it's still very much an art-based project all the time.
Yeah, yeah. That's really cool.
Yeah, a bit of fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Choice.
Yeah.
And how about you, Ehoa? What was your journey like?
Yeah, I always wanted to do something. I always thought I was going to be, like, a cartoonist.
Mm.
And yeah, I just, art was the only thing I did at Kura. And then went into secondary school, pretty much didn't do any other subject but art. And that was, and then...
Which unfortunately back in those days they make you feel stink for that, eh?
Well, I did wanted to do painting, photography and art. all in the same, and design, sorry. And
yeah.
It wasn't until I was like seventh form that I had a teacher, Blair Hungerford, who kind of laid out design and that process for me.
Choice.
And I really took to it.
Yeah,
and I was like kind of stuck on that, so I thought I'd go to design school. Mm. Went to Victoria.
Yeah.
Because I didn't know any better, to be honest. I was just like, okay, finish school, go to uni, but struggled heaps at uni.
Yeah.
Just kind of like, fuck, I don't really want to do this. And then realised that I had a couple of projects that I did during that I kind of wanted to go back to.
Mm.
Yeah, and it wasn't until I went travelling for years and years and years overseas. Came back and was like, okay, I'm going to start trying to do this.
Yeah.
But yeah, and that's how it all kind of began.
Yeah.
The kind of crossover into doing kind of, you know, graphic design for marketing and branding for people and stuff like that, into actually going, actually, I can do this myself. Mm. And using my culture as it being the driving force for I wanted to kind of achieve, and that's how the kind of first kind of kaupapa started of Hori, and that whole bloody story.
What was your very first kaupapa that you did under that brand?
I did a self-identity, it was probably my second year photography class, and did a self-identity project which looked at the stereotype of the Hori. Whether it be, I think there was like a Bloody Mary piece, which was me basically beaten up and bleeding, like I'd just been in a scrap, and it was, you know, then there was like a, like your road worker kind of, you know, just kind of rough and rugged, and that kind of looking at those stereotypes and how I was perceived by people just because my name was Hori. Hori or Hori, but my actual name is Hohepa.
Oh, yeah.
But I went to a really predominant Pākehā school and I knocked my teeth out and, you know, because Hohepa kind of goes really well with Hori, I got stuck with that name. And I fucking hated it, but I kind of had, it's about kind of reclaiming that, that kupu. And doing exactly. more positive and quite challenging, because the name is quite challenging to both worlds, whether it be in, you know, Pākehā or Māori. Then putting that in, kind of not making, making people bloody uncomfortable, doing pretty ruthless kaupapa that we look into. Well, quite intense and serious issues. But then there's the personality side of it as well, which is, you know, taking the piss. You know, not taking the piss, but having a bit of fun with things, not being so serious and tūturu.
And that's what I love about your brand. Like, it's so clever and meaningful, but it's hard case. And you get all of that in the one in the one kind of whatever it is, whether it's a picture or a graphic design or even your like sale sign that you put out saying 50% off nothing, pay full price, man. Don't be sad. I love that. I love how you do that.
Just being really kind of authentic and honest with people. Just like, I know I'm pretty brutal, but Mia will know.
What's been one of like your biggest challenges being such a an artist in this kind of space, taking on some of these, you know, these tougher things for our people?
I think in the beginning was the reaction from our elders. So that was really hard to take, because, you know, growing up knowing tikanga and that kind of space and challenging that, you always, as you're younger growing up, you just, you listen to your kuia, you listen to your karawa and your mama and papa and, you know, uncles and aunties, but then sometimes they're wrong. And sometimes the tikanga that they've been, that you've been kind of learning is actually a colonial tikanga that they've been they've been running with.
Totally.
It doesn't actually
I get you, bro. I'm the same with my whanau. I'm always like, shut up, man.
Under
my breath though.
I think it was a bit like that at the start, and then I actually really started coming out and going and challenging, like, but why? You know, it's it doesn't make kind of any sense to me. But yeah, at the beginning that was the hard thing, was taking that from whānau. Biggest critics are my actual whānau, so you know, it's especially kind of those Māori politics that get, you know, Māori and politics are just as bad as Pākehā politics. So
100%
You've got that whole kind of kōrero that's going on, and uncle's saying this and you shouldn't be doing that, and you're just so you have to kind of just kind of have a, I've learnt, like, over the last, what, 10 years we've been doing this now, 10 years next year, is to be, you know, come from a really, solid foundation, which we have now, and yeah, just go for it. Like, just, like, Kyle, this is what I'm going to do. And then, shit, if you get it wrong, you know, got to face that, that you got that wrong, and it happens too.
Yeah,
yeah, so, I mean, yeah, it's just all learning, eh?
Absolutely, and I think being a creative is, like, it's such a vulnerable process, eh? You come up with a concept, you express yourself through that concept, what you think about it, and then visually you're expressing how you represent that, and then people will just shoot you down. They don't even care, like, and you have to get used to it. I agree. We've got a, and with our crew in Manukau, like, everything that we do is about trying to help bring out the potential of Māori and Pasifika in South Auckland mostly, but we're trying to focus around all of Aotearoa as well. And that's one of the things that I see all the time, and I say to them all the time, like, you need to learn to be vulnerable, but you also got to have thick skin and let it just rush off.
That's right.
Yeah.
That, I think that's was the hardest thing for me, because I'm actually a little bit more reserved, and Hori's like the exact opposite, and he's – all good. He has thicker skin.
Yeah.
Whereas I was a little bit more delicate. I've definitely learned.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was a learning for me.
Yeah.
Put a little bit of armor on.
How do you learn to deal with that stuff?
Time.
Yeah.
Experience.
Yeah. It's in the beginning it was real. I used to get quite
get you down.
Yeah, hurt, yeah. Because, you know, some were coming from artists that you really looked up to.
Mm. Not anymore, or, eh? Now they're voodoo dolls.
Always did. Like, no, I remember there was one, yeah, and I'd used him as artist role models for my students and stuff, and then seeing stuff that, you know, and I was like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
But that was years and years and years back. But, you know, or just like, you know, old queer down the road that might say something cool, you know, someone down, you know, anywhere.
Mm.
And you're just like, yeah, yep. But fuck it, that's what I'm doing.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what I believe. And yep, hey, aha.
Yeah.
That's it. And you can have your kōrero and your opinion and your whakaros are yours, and I respect that, but you know, this is actually mine.
Mm.
And actually there's actually a lot of people that have this whakaro but maybe not have the kōrero to kind of come out and say it.
Yeah.
And the platform.
Totally, eh?
Well, yeah, that all, you know, with creatively with the works, which actually are really, some of them can be quite confronting to look at.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially when we're looking at these really kind of rough issues that are on our Māori people today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hard out. I remember as a photography student, I told you, I think I shared with you before, how my koro passed away while I was studying. He was our patriarch. He was the leader of our whānau, the one that we all looked up to and followed. So it was, and he died quite suddenly, and so it was a big thing for our whānau. And one of the ways that grieving process came out is that my whānau felt that some of the photos that I had taken weren't appropriate, and they made me give up all my negatives and all my photos, and they buried them, but I hid heaps and I didn't give them to them. I remember thinking, like you said before, some of these tikanga that they come up with, like, what is that? I don't know where that came from and why you felt that was something that had to be done, and why burying these pieces of plastic and paper was going to have any kind of weight. So there's definitely been things through the journey where you're just like, as a part of the whānau, I'll just submit to it and roll with it, but I wasn't going to keep the ones I really, really like. Nah. You guys aren't having access to those. I don't even think I've told any of them that, so we see that.
I know, people are just grieving processes.
It is,
with whānau, or like, you know, especially like your ways, their iwi, that's a, you don't with photos of dead people.
Like, yeah.
Tūpuna.
Mm.
Yeah, it's like they will put a warning on television
that
there'll be some person that has passed away for the Indigenous people.
And they'll put a photo up of them.
Well, their photos, they don't have those photos.
Oh yeah.
That's kind of kawa over there as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My photos, so just to clarify, were photos of taonga that he had carved and stuff.
Oh, right.
Yeah, so they were images of things that he had created and and area spaces that he was in and things like that. So yeah, they didn't even have people in them, which I thought was a bit weird, but. Hey, we'll move on. I guess all of that to say that we're all walking through our own journey, all processing it, and as a creative, it is an area that is not black and white. And so for those that aren't comfortable in a creative space, I think they've got to find some kind of, like, I don't know, something they can really hold on to. And and quite often I feel like the creative side can get the blame for stuff because it's not easily understood, I suppose, or has lots of different perspectives, can be picked apart. But how did you fellas transition from or start to build a living out of your creativity? How did that happen? Because most artists, man, you got to be okay with being pōhara for a while, eh?
Oh, yeah.
100%.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
We've been there.
Yeah.
We have. It's very humble beginnings and, it's a long process, and when I look back at how we, you know, just stayed positive, oh, we just need to sell, you know, this amount of T-shirts, or, you know, like, it was very small steps and a really amazing learning to not be able to afford cheese.
Yeah.
Or just go, petrol, you know, you've got to,
But we're on the bones.
So you hit that, eh? But not anymore.
No, we just bought our first house.
Awesome.
And grown-ups. I mean, we're grown-ups now.
Such big grown-ups.
Sometimes, eh?
Oh, yeah. Never. It's crazy. Just kind of, and it, you know what, it's only like really in the last 2-3 years. Even like kind of 3 years ago, we're still struggling.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was, I don't know what happened. It was just a switch that, and then everything started to pay off a bit.
Set yourself goals.
Yeah, also.
And then, I don't know, we've been very blessed, I think.
Yeah. What were some of your early goals as far as like this pathway goes? Like, first step, let's do this, and then we can go to that part.
First step was just having the confidence to get the gallery, I think.
Yeah.
With no experience. I had luckily worked in a gallery in Byron for many years, which was fantastic.
Oh, awesome, yeah.
But no, you know, our business and our art and our clothing and, it was literally, okay, so this is the rent, this is how much we need to sell, you know, and it just literally was just a one step at a time, and each week it just got a little bit easier. But we definitely had some rough weeks. I think we were very lucky, but we both knew this is what we wanted to do, and we committed to it.
Yeah,
but you have to, because you have to sign a lease.
So you always thought having a gallery. Like, what is the dream?
The dream is for complete mana motuhake. So we've achieved it. You know, to have our whare at our new studio down the beach. And, you know, we've just, I was saying about the new cafe and gallery studio that we're opening up down the, you know, so it's everything is there, our whānau. Everything at the beach, where I grew up, where our kids grew up, for me, that's my dream.
Man, and you're pretty much there, eh?
We're there, yeah.
Yeah, so
we're getting there. So we're just, you know, we didn't want to pay landlords' rents. We wanted to be doing our own mortgage, but then we went a step further, and we're like, let's get a space where we can commercially work from. So. We've got one of the three spaces out the beach that are able to do that. So,
awesome.
So yeah, it's the complete. That's gonna be next year. We open
November
this year.
We're manifesting. Are you guys gonna run the cafe too?
Yeah, we'll get people into work.
Yeah, you're a good cook, or
not bad. Just start off with
just the start off
juices, nice fresh juices, smoothies,
over summer
coffee,
just kai, coconuts. A real community kind of hub.
Yeah, that's choice.
That's the big.
Don't need to overcomplicate it.
Oh, no, simple's easy. Yeah,
just start small.
Yeah.
Still, I take risks, like you know, and I'm like, I'll say it all the time. To me, like, oh, fuck it, we'll get it back. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
And she's like, but no, it's okay. You know, we might have to fork out a couple of K on this, but it's okay. It'll come back. So being like that, it's really hard to do, but I am, you know, a bit like that.
And the more you do it, the more comfortable you get, you reckon? The more confident you are in stepping out?
His confidence. Yeah.
I can just cheer him on, eh?
Trust it.
Yeah, I'm sure these are pretty.
Aww.
It's the one, eh?
Turn the page.
So do you guys feel okay to share, like, what actually is your business model right now? How do you guys actually make money?
So online's massive.
Yes.
You know, we're on the main drag of, you know, Highway 1.
Yeah.
So a lot of the shops here really rely on walk-ins.
Yeah.
We don't.
Yeah.
Which is really awesome. So we, it's great when they do come in, but a lot of the people that come here are coming here to either buy the art, buy the clothes, and they've seen it either online or they're buying online. Mm. So we're pretty lucky.
And then as a gallery model, how does that work? Is it like a sales commission or?
Yeah, so we just take commission.
Yeah. And not until it's the sales made.
All the other artists.
Whatever. No. No, you're in their buyers.
We do
that's
a pretty standard, pretty standard commission rate on all our other artists, then they're comfortable with it.
And it's only once it's sold?
Yeah, we're more like, because we're artists, we go to them first. What do you need for this?
Mm.
Like, what do you need to make it work? Yeah. And then we'll be like, ka pai.
Yeah.
And then we put our commission on top.
Yeah,
of that.
Yeah.
So we never ever take from them.
Mm.
Or, you know, some of them have already got their, you know, retail prices in. So it is what it is. That's what they're getting. That's what you're getting.
Yeah. I'm keen to hear more from you guys about like community and the role of community. Doing what you're doing as artists, but then also in the commercial side. Mm. Like, how do you, how important is a community of artists and buyers, and how do you build that?
You got this one?
You got it. we've been very lucky in the community that we live.
Mm.
Our community support us, and it's a cultural bubble.
Mm.
It just is magic here.
Yeah.
And we're very lucky to have loads of local support, which, you know, it's amazing. Mm.
It's massive. Ōtaki's just completely from, you know, at the start when we came in, they were pretty much like, who the hell are these guys?
Yeah, there was a
seriously.
He's this cheeky bugger, eh?
Yep, they were. But then it was like, hi guys, I'm back.
Yeah.
And now, like, the tautoko that we have from this community is amazing.
Yeah.
And we, you know, we put a lot into out there. You know, all of our tamariki at the kura, you know, kohanga, you know, my kids at the same kohanga I was at, you know.
Wow.
Kind of 35
That's
years
special,
later.
Eh?
Yeah, it's pretty special. You know, same kuia that took me. We're teaching our kids and now they're at the local kura and our mates are all working there and all the kind of whānaus that I grew up with, they're all working there. So it's a really, you know, Ōtaki's an amazing space for our people.
Yeah.
And they really tautoko kind of Māori and indigenous businesses.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and then outside of that, I think...
We use local printers.
Yeah.
Sewers, embroiderers. So we have, we're really fortunate in that way as well.
Yeah, awesome.
Mm.
All just down the road, eh?
Yeah.
And then about, like, building this community, like, the artists that come into your gallery or your artists, you know, friends and that support you through the highs and the lows or that you collaborate on. What's that like, building that?
It's just been, at the start, I was kind of like, you know, I'd just go to my, you know, I loved Tummy's work ever since I was, you know, always kind of looked up to him and then now to have him and, you know, working closely and have his work in here is kind of a bit of a fangirl for me. But, but now it's quite funny because quite good mates. But, you know, and all the other artists that I really, you know, Zoe, you know, being in Wellington and you can't not see any of Zoe's stuff all over Pōneka there.
Yeah.
She's just lives up the road now, and it's awesome. Her and Ollie just bought their new house in Te Horo. So, you know, it's just just a really awesome bunch of crew, and you know that all together, like the, you know, it's a very close kind of the Wellington kind of artist kind of community. You know, we're just kind of on the outskirts there, but
By the beach, too.
Because
is it fair to say without them you guys wouldn't be where you're at financially?
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean,
so it's so important, eh?
it's just...
But it's more than that, obviously, more than the cash.
Yeah, no, nah, it's just having, like, having the mahi in here. It just, the Māori in here is just like, you know, when you come in to this, to our gallery, it's not like any, I feel, you know, and I'll go into every single gallery I can possibly go to if I go to any town, and it's different.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it is. It's that Māori that's in here that's just a little bit kind of like, should I walk in there? Or
I really want to walk in
there. But,
And then, so then you've also got to have buyers. How do you do that? How do you find the people with the pūtea to buy this type of art?
Again, I think we've been really lucky. We have a supportive following on Instagram. Mm. You know, whenever Hori does a post, it's real comments, real people loving the work. It's the amount of people that come in here and say, I follow you on Instagram.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I'm so chuffed.
Influencer.
Yeah. Oh, really? Like, yeah, I always think that that's been a really amazing platform.
Yeah.
And then just to show off what we have in the gallery, all the stories. And
yeah.
What do you think, Hori? Is that
I think that's been
huge.
Facebook was like, you know, kind of five, 6 years ago was massive, and then we started getting into Instagram.
It's still,
and Instagram now is, like, massive.
Mm.
So next up, TikTok, eh?
Well, I started an account.
Did you?
I did,
but Mia was like, don't do it, Hori. I was like,
do it. I don't know.
I think
I don't know what to do.
I can't keep watching all the things, but I just think it'll be funny to do, like, just funny shit on it.
Yeah, you don't have to do the really dances. Funny. You can do whatever. It's just where the attention is at the moment. Yeah. That's all, eh? You do make it sound like it's effortless, even though we know it's not, eh?
I don't know. It's making sure, like, I know some people aren't big on it, but, you know, we're a whānau-based business.
Mm.
So, you know, we have our whānau have grown up in this gallery. It's going to be the hardest thing about kind of moving on.
Yeah.
Our whānau's and our everything is so, like, in everything of this work.
Yeah.
That's the one thing that people kind of might not see is the, you know, it's our mums that are looking after our kids while we're able to work in here.
Yeah.
It's all of those things. So that it's a whole whānau that's kind of making this all work.
Yeah.
So true.
And it's massive, eh? So it's, and it's our friends.
Mm.
It's this town. It's everyone that kind of makes it all work. And because it is quite, like, I try to be as authentic as possible. Like, no bullshit, just like, fucking, this is it.
Yeah.
This is what we're doing. If you like it, ka pai. If you don't, fucking.
Ka pai.
All good. But
it's choice, I reckon. I feel like sometimes it comes with getting a bit older as well, getting enough hits at you to get to the point where you're like, actually, it's all good.
Yeah.
Like, you like it or you don't. Right. It doesn't mean anything to me either way. But if you're in, then that's us. Let's go. Yeah.
The other thing I try to tell people is that the art can be very separate from the artist.
Mm.
So, you know, you might not like that artist, but you don't know that person.
Yeah. Totally.
Especially some of the artists that are in here.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't like him.
Oh.
Or I don't like that work. I'm like, yeah, but you don't know the person, so.
Yeah.
Once you know the person, then you can say you don't like that person.
Yeah.
But that's all negative chat.
It is, eh? And the people are going to have opinions. Haters going to hate. That's how it is, eh?
If you're lucky enough to do something that you love.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That we've been really fortunate to be able to do it.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's not effortless, but it is enjoyable. It's work that we love to do.
Yeah, totally.
And artists that we love to look at their work every day. It's that's the
yeah
That's the easy part of it, is just doing what you love.
Yeah.
Even last night I got back from rugby training, I was fucked. Mm. And Leah was like, hey, I just made these new jerseys. And I was like, oh, yep, here we go. So I just want to put something on. And I was just like, oh, yeah. And then, you know, that's how it starts. Boom. Yeah. And then we're on the computer and we're like.
And then I saw him first thing this morning on the computer.
And yeah, there, just
like doing it again.
You knew though, eh? You plant the little seed, it'll grow overnight.
Yep. And it did. And then it's come long. And then I'm like, it's actually going to look mean.
That's awesome.
Oh, choice.
Yeah. So
exciting. Like, I can't wait to see it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's nothing. We're not reinventing the wheel, really.
We're not. We've
already had it. But
Yeah,
awesome. You fellas talked a little bit, and we can chat a little bit about this later, but we're pretty lucky, shout out to Shopify, to get them to support this hiding that we're on and there's Kōrero, and particularly to those Shopify. That use Shopify. I know that you guys use Shopify.
We do.
All the platforms, why did you choose that one?
We switched last year.
September, didn't we?
Was it?
Yeah.
Through the lockdown, you know, we were on another, I won't mention.
Another but, one.
Another one of those things. and one of the bros, Harpy, was like, look, I've been doing this thing, and I got hold of him. It was a bit of a drunken chat. I was like, yeah, bro, yeah, you should come help me. And then he was like, yep, sweet. So then we started looking at Shopify and just the different inputs and everything that you have on the back end of it that made our lives way better in terms of seeing live views. You know, it's a bit creepy.
Oh,
I do.
You can turn into a bit of a stalker, right?
Well,
I do like all the seeing
analytics.
Love it.
Yeah. It's so a bit weird.
Enjoyable.
Yeah.
You know, you feel like you're a bloody big brother in the sky. Like,
it's amazing, eh? What you can pull out on people. And what do they know about me?
And now what are they thinking? Like, what? He's in my head. But, like, you know. Yeah, you can see, like, you know, oh, yep, that person's filled up their
shopping cart,
but didn't quite.
They've abandoned it.
Abandoned
it. So, boom, abandoned cart email, here it goes.
Why didn't you hit the proceed button and the pay button? So I found that was real cool.
Yeah
I think.
Because I'd never seen that shit before, so I was like, ooh.
And the things that people look for, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So then you know what to... You know what to put on.
Mm.
You know they've seen someone wearing something, so they're searching for it.
And yeah,
It's something that we've got in here and not online. You can see all that.
Yeah, like these vests.
That's cool.
These are the ones now that we know the Toa Army vests, are like right top.
Yeah,
that's
choice.
What people are looking for.
Yeah.
And even this one that we haven't brought out yet.
The boil up.
Things we're doing.
Onesie.
Yeah.
People have started searching them.
Oh yeah.
But they're not online yet.
Yeah. In store only, eh?
Well, they're not coming out until a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
But, choice.
But that's a very cool thing.
Yeah.
Analytics and seeing who your audience is is amazing.
Would you say it's helped your business grow?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Wahine ma. Well. Nga mihi ki a koutou katoa.
Oh, che.
Yeah, we've just seen the, what was it, 85%?
The pie chart of, you know, who's looking at your things.
Mm. Mm.
That's incredible.
85% wahine.
Aye.
Wow.
Yep.
So it's mean that Mia's...
I know.
...doing all of that.
To be.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it's, you know, when I started doing it, it was like, all my mates all surf and snowboarders and skaters and that, so it was always just guys stuff.
Mm.
So, you know, to have that wahine,
like a unisex vibe going on.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah,
and a lot of them are like, you know, just all, you know.
And maybe they're the ones that do the shopping too, eh? They buy them for their tane and stuff 100%. As well.
Yeah, I'm not even allowed to have it. Debit card in my life.
Be overs, eh?
I'm not.
So that's the secret to creating wealth, eh? Cut off the debit card.
Just cut.
Mean. All right, well, last little question from me, I suppose, is what's on the horizon for you fellas? What's coming up next?
The gallery cafe.
Yep.
That's huge. Yep. That's all I think about.
Yeah, choice.
And I also just think about new clothing range, which we were just doing last night.
Mm.
What else?
Well, yeah, the church, that's what we're calling
the church.
It.
Yeah.
That's going to be the new caf that will be connected to the new whare toi. And, yeah, that's the big, big thing for us. We had a couple of exhibitions overseas that got canned, but
yeah.
I think for me, art-wise, is to push overseas. I think there's a massive thing, especially in London, England, for us to go over there. And then in the States. We're sending, it's weird, we're sending stuff to some weird countries, but it's cool, you know. Canadian, you know, people and Kiwis that are in Canada giving you specs to their houses, telling you to, I want all your stuff to deck my house out.
Yeah.
You know, just stuff like that where, you know, New Zealander pats that are just all over, you know, Australia, London, you know, States, Canada, like a lot of these, Japan, that are all over there and they just want that piece of
feeling homesick.
Home.
Yeah.
Aye.
Yeah.
And just have a bit more kind of sass, maybe.
But an attitude, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, so that's for me. What about you, mate?
I already said mine.
Yeah. Just that
first.
And you're just you're just humbly helping Ōtaki be reo Māori speaking, right?
Oh, yeah.
Just humbly.
Huge. Well, the thing about Ōtaki is that it is probably, I'm going to say it, it is the most bilingual taone in Aotearoa.
Yep.
I feel it is. And so it's nothing new. You go into Ōtaki into, you know, people come through here, the main street, and they think that this is Ōtaki.
Mm.
Te Taone Tūturu is kind of in the middle there towards the beach. So, you know, you've got four kura kaupapa, you know, three kohanga reo, puna reo, you know, reo rua classes, you know, everything, and you've got Te Wānanga Raukawa.
Yeah.
So all based in this town, in this tiny little town.
Mm.
And, you know, hearing Māori being spoken is just not a weird thing here.
Yeah.
Our rugby team, you know, completely fluent, like most of them. So our whakaaro was to just build on what, you know, our teachers had taught us at Raukawa and take it into more mainstream spaces. It's called trueōtaki.co.nz. Every business in here, we've got 70 businesses involved now.
Choice.
And it's just about kind of making te reo in really bite-sized pieces so businesses can use it all around, whether it be signage. But signage is not enough for us.
Mm.
We're like, yep, I can blanket this entire town. You give me enough paint and I'll do it.
Yeah.
But it's not good enough. It needs to be heard.
Mm.
So seen and heard and used, because, you know, you want people to come through, and basically in that small time that they come through, you want them to have a little te reo lesson.
Right.
You know, before they leave this town, that they get a little lesson, and just like, even if it's just kia ora.
Yeah.
And ka kite. You know, just the most simplest little thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, can you imagine every single store, every single shop, all translated into te reo Māori?
Mm.
So yeah, so that's the big one this year, the kind of little kaupapa that we're
the other doing. Big one, eh?
Well, you know,
it's a big one.
Yeah.
It's a big one, but Yeah, it's not an idea that we came up with.
Mm.
We're just kind of, it's the right thing
getting
to
behind,
do.
Eh?
Yeah. And a lot of other kind of people have, you know, really jumping on board with us.
Mm.
In the next couple of months, you'll see Ōtaki really start, especially in the next 3 months, you'll really start it to be seen into really kind of bigger spaces that you would never have thought
awesome
taking it on. So it's kind of, yeah, you've got to get the big dogs done first, and then we're kind of just, I think it'll snowball. But yeah, it's like every rubbish bin, every light, every rama, like rapahi, everything, the floor, the ground, everything.
Yeah. Choice.
Done in all in te reo.
Yeah. Chūōtaki.co.nz.
Bigger picture, chūōtaki.co.nz. Yeah, so this is the basis, the kind of foundation, ground up stuff we'll learn. And the whakaro is to kind of give that mātauranga off to other towns that kind of want to take a shot at the table, at the title. And also challenge other towns to,
think you can. But a healthy competition out there, eh?
I think it's cool. It's just like throwing that weddle out.
Yeah, going, definitely.
Come on, Rotorua.
I know that. Yeah, come on then.
Come on, Rotorua.
Come on then, Cubs.
Yeah, that's the kind of big game.
Yeah. Well, tēnā kōrua, tēnei te mihi nunui kia kōrua mō tēnei kōrero, mō tō manaakitanga. Thank you so much for having us. Being so generous with sharing your journey and your wisdom. Whether you feel wise or not, you've got heaps of experience. So that's me, Naz. I can't wait to be able to share this with everyone. So thanks for having us.
Nah, thanks for coming. Thank you.
Choice. Ka kite, eh?
Ka kite konei.